Hello and welcome to my tutorial on manipulating textures and objects that you want to build onto a 3D avatar directly within Photoshop. So the first thing you want to do is download the files that you need. I originally got these files from a tutorial source that I found online, and when I went to check for it because a friend had asked me for it, I found that the site is now 404, so it's not available anymore. That's the reason why I'm doing this tutorial and doing it in a video format, to make it easy for you. So I've uploaded the files to my own website, to the Exodus website, and I've uploaded my version of it. So this version is already resized to 1024 by 1024. It has bake layers included, and for the female avatar rather, and it also has an additional layer on there to get you started. So you're going to want to go to exodusinc.net, and I'll put the link down in the doobly-doo. And then once you're there, you're going to want to mouse over to Sweetie Stuff, and then Avatar PSDs. So a couple of things that you're going to need before you get started is, first, in order to uncompress the file, you're going to need WinRAR. And in order to use the file, you need CS4 Photoshop Extended or better. So if you've got those two things, all you need to do now is to hit that download link, and it will download the RAR file to your hard drive, and it's about 30 megs, so make sure that you've got the space for it. I'm assuming that you do. Once you've got that done, put it in the location that you want it. Extract these four files that you need. If that's something different, it's just these four files. So I'm going to work with female av, since probably the majority of creators make things for the female av. And I'm just going to double click that to open it, and it opens up directly into Photoshop. Alright, so this is a 3D model. So you've got here, I'm not sure how you have your tools arranged. Mine are over here on the left. You've got your zoom tool, so let's hit fit screen. And you've got your 3D tools. And these 3D tools, if you want to zoom in to get a good look at a section of the avatar, then you're going to want to use the 3D tools instead of the zoom tool, because if you use the zoom and get in close, then everything looks like crap because it's pixelated. Instead, use the 3D tools. And you can, the fourth button here, fifth, whatever, allows you to zoom in. As you can see, yeah, a crotch shot. Ass shot. To wherever it is that you need it to go. So, in your 3D tools, you've got the home button. That loads the last save position before you close the file. Then you've got the orbiter. This orbits on the XY axis. And you've got another rotate tool. Rotate you around. You've got a panning tool. You can go up and down. And you can another panning tool, which allows you to zoom in, but it's a little bit shaky. If you don't have a steady hand, it can be a little bit annoying. So the next tool is a nice zoom tool. It's nice and smooth. You can get right into the area that you want to work with if you want to line up a seam or whatever you want to do. So let's put that back to the home position. So as you can see, your avatar is a bit dark and difficult to work with because the light source is somewhere, I guess, over here. So you're looking at a lot of shade. Probably what you want is to have something that looks like full bright. So to do that, click on 3D menu, and you want the rendering settings, which I can't see immediately, so I need to hit show all menu items, and then render settings show up there. Render settings. Okay, and then right in the first column here, we've got face style. Solid, which is what it's at now. We want unlit texture. An unlit texture, there you go, as you can see, is much like the in-world's full bright function. And then I'm going to hit set default, so that way that becomes the new default. So every time when I open up a 3D model, hopefully we'll have this as a default. And then hit OK. Alright, so now our layers. These are smart objects. So we've got material head, material top, and material bottom. So material head, it will pop up. Maybe if I hold it long enough, there you go. You can see that's the head texture, and you've got your top texture, and your bottom texture. If you double click, or if you hit the eye button actually, you can see that it makes it invisible, which turns it white. If you double click it, it will open this up. Alright, so depending on how you have your settings set up, I prefer to work with everything in tabs. You might have yours in tile, that's fine. If you want to follow along with what I'm doing, you just hit Window, go to Range, and then Consolidate all to tabs, and that will open these up in tabs. So here I've included a baked texture. It's in a group on its own because it's convenient, but you can make the whole group invisible. Then I've got a blank layer and then the background layer. So I'm going to select the blank layer and then go back to my model. That updates. And then I want to go to material top, open that up, that gives you an idea of what that looks like. Alright, let's hit fit screen so you can see. Again, same thing, you've got a baked layer, a blank layer, and a bottom layer. I probably didn't do this for the mail ad or anything with the skirts because I tend not to use those things. But you can create those yourself if you choose to. Alright, go back to model and then material bottom. Same thing, go fit screen, and then as you can see, the baked texture, blank layer, and your background layer. So I'm going to select, make sure that blank layer is selected, blank layer selected, blank layer selected. Good. Okay. So, if you are, now you have the opportunity to draw directly onto the model. And the advantage to this is that when you're painting directly on the model, more than likely, let's do it this way, it will line up the seams exactly how you intend to. So you don't have to do it on a two-dimensional flat surface and then test it in the world and test upload and upload and upload and upload and upload until you get the seams right. It'll most likely be much easier to work directly with the 3D model and then upload it when you get it as close as you can. Now I still do recommend testing uploads, doing test uploads with temporary uploads if you can, simply because the 3D model might not look might not render exactly as it would in the world, so it's worth doing a test upload anyways. So I'm gonna switch to my pen here. There's purple line right here is the seam between material top and material bottom. So I'm going to just draw a wavy line so you can see how that seams up. So already it's already lined up. I don't have to fudge with it. I don't have to use Liquify or any of those other tools in order to get those to line up. It's already perfectly done. And to show you that, there's material top and you can see it there. And it's on layer one. The reason why I did it on layer one and not the background layer is because when I'm uploading clothes in world, I don't want these ugly lines. I'm going to put it on its own layer. So make sure that you have that new layer selected. Alright, so once you've got started on here, you can go back to your 3D model. And just to demonstrate, what can happen is if you're painting on the 3D model itself. So let's say I'm doing something wrong here and I make a mistake and I hit Control Z to undo. This will have broken the link between the model and your open material layers. So if I were to go to, so see, because I painted over it, it's already screwed up because it's broken the link and it's not working properly. So I hit Control Z. Now if I go here, it's showing funny. It's showing funny. So it broke the link between the two. So this is your current model. This is what is accurate, and then you see here it's all wrong. So if you close these two, you're back to your 3D model and you reopen it here, you're double clicking the layers, it is appearing now how it should be. It'll change the name at the top, it'll say material top, sometimes it'll just be a number PSB, and that's fine. Material bottom, So now let's say you've got PSD templates of clothing or skin and you want to import those onto the 3D model. It can be done, and you don't have to copy paste every single layer, because that can be, let's face it, a huge pain in the ass. So I'm going to show you how to do that. So I have downloaded an avatar clothing template from one of my favorite template creators, which I can manipulate. So I've got lower skirt frame texture and upper. It's a dress, as you can probably tell. It's going to open up in a new tab. There we go. And it's got all of these layers here. And as you would probably imagine, it would be a real royal pain in the ass to copy and paste each layer directly, especially when it's got layer styles on it, which won't copy properly over to that avatar. So there is another way to do it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up both of those. So I can see them both. And I'm going to make this background layer visible. Now, first thing I'm going to do is create a group, and creating a group is going to make it easier in order to pull everything onto your model. So I'm going to create a new group. It's in a funny place, it shouldn't be there. I should have moved it up. There we go. New group, doesn't matter what, you can leave it as is, you can change the name, it doesn't matter. Then I'm going to copy this background layer, and I'm going to copy it because I want to include it in the group, because it'll make it easy for me to line everything up when I get it over to the model. And do the same with the lower portion of the dress. Duplicate layer. Okay, so in order to move the layers, let's go to the top, let's make a new group. So make a new group, hit this little button here, group, and then select the layers. You can either hold down shift or control and select them all individually, or if you're moving all of them, you can start at the bottom, select the bottom layer, hold down your shift key, and then select the top layer that you want, and then drag them into the group. There we go. Now it's all in one group, nice and neat and tidy. Do the same thing here. There we go, nice and neat and tidy. Alright, so let's go back to our 3D model. And let's open up material top. Let's delete that layer, drag that into the garbage. It's going to update, there we go. And material bottom, drag that into the bottom too. Alright, so now what we can do is drag those layers from lower and upper into these two. So what we're going to do in order to do that, the easiest way that I know how, is to tile everything. So you go to Window, Arrange, Tile. Click on the window that you want. So you've got the group selected, hit the Move tool, and then drag that whole group into your material top. And then do the same thing for our material bottom. So you've got your Move tool, drag the entire group into material bottom. Now your layers are not lined up properly. So we're going to want to put everything back into tabs because it's easier for me. So I'm going to go to Window, Arrange, Consolidate to Tabs. And then I don't need those upper and lower anymore. So we're going to close those. No, I don't need to save it. Close that. Okay, so I'm just going to have that material top and material bottom. Kind of rearrange things, that doesn't matter. So start with material top. Have the mood tool. Let's fit screen first so we can line it up a little better. So we're just going to move it until all the corners match up. And this is why I had the seams visible, because when it comes to matching up, it's easier to match up the corners than it is to match up the actual clothing onto the model, because if it's wrong, then it can screw up all of your seams, and that can be annoying. Okay, and then I just made that invisible, or you can delete it, you can drag it into the garbage bin, doesn't matter, whatever you like. And I'm going to do the same for material bottom. Go to fit screen, grab the move tool, move these down. So I'm going to get it as close as I can, and then I'm going to use my arrow keys to nudge it. That looks good. Open up that group and make that background, old background visible. There we go. And now let's have a look at the 3D model. And it's updated, and there we have it. So we now have a working copy of our template or of our clothing or whatever it is that you're working with on the 3D model, so you can get in there and edit the parts that you need, line up the seams, whatever it is that you need to do directly on the model, or check it on the model before you upload it into Second Life. And as you can see, you've got all the original layers with all the layer styles, nice and neat, exactly where you need them. Now, so say that you've already got everything the way you want it to be. You've edited it in both on the model, you've lined up all your seams, and you're now ready to upload to Second Life. All that you would really need to do is make that background invisible. Go to File, Save for Web and Devices. Now, file size and format. You can use TARGAs, TGAs, but Second Life now supports PNGs, as most of you probably already know. So I recommend you go with PNG 24. Yes, you want to have transparency because it's not a matte background, and use 1024 by 1024. With most clothing and skins, you're going to want to use 1024 by 1024. You can use 512. However, if for those who are using computers that support graphics and their viewers, anything above low or mid, clothing and skin might look really pixelated and poor, so higher resolution the better. The only exception would be perhaps is to say if you're making a texture for a small prim, like say you're a shoe creator and you're making a skin to fit over a sculpted foot, you might choose to use a smaller file such as 512 instead of a 1024 by 1024, because as it's small anyways, you're not going to see a lot of the tiny minute detail, and the 512 is going to load a lot faster than the 1024, especially on a small prim. That's why you often might see people walking around with gray feet, because the creator has used a 1024 instead of a 512. So that's my advice. Most of the time use 1024 unless you're making a texture for a very small prim. So you're going to save it to whatever location that you want on your hard drive. I'm going to hit cancel because I don't want to save it. And then you're ready to upload to Second Life and test in world, and that's all there is to it. You're ready to go. So that's it for this tutorial. I hope that you've enjoyed it and that it will be useful to you for your creation needs in Second Life. Thank you for watching, and take care.